Another guy doing a great job joining us now. We stick with the basketball theme because it's been an interesting ride for our guest now. First of all, he's an outstanding player. We go back to L.B. Landry and then to Belhaven. I mean, it's a guy that averaged 16 a game, shot nearly 60% from the field, and was really good for Belhaven. And then, of course, once his playing career ended, he's back in New Orleans, and he's been serving as the head coach of the Carver Rams, who had a very intriguing season this past season, which we'll get into, among other things. It's a pleasure to welcome the outstanding coach of the Carver Rams, Nate Rocher, to the show. Listen, Nate, thanks for joining us. Great to have you with us. Welcome to the show.
Oh, man, definitely, man. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. And, you know, I go back to those playing games. You still got game, right? You can still run those gassers and you can still post people up, right? I'm sure.
Oh, yeah, man, a little bit. I try to get out there every now and then when time and my body permits it. Try to show those young guys what I got, man, or what I had.
It wasn't that long ago, and I remember it pretty well. Interesting season for – talk about your basketball team first, the Carver Rams, and what you had this past year. Just what you went through was unprecedented. I don't know that anybody's ever played every game on the road before. You were forced to do it because of a sanction that was – understandable given the circumstances of what happened the previous year, and there's no need to get in all the extraneous details, but there was a mishap on the floor, a scuffle in a game that you did not start but were part of, and the penalty came down. First and foremost, how tough was it to deal with that sanction, to know going in that you had to play every game on the road?
It was challenging. We definitely had to refocus ourselves. That whole situation was kind of devastating for us that year because we had a special group of kids that really came in and bought into what we were trying to do. They fought really hard. They had a good year. You know, just getting hit with that kind of made us refocus and just try to do a lot of things different.
Well, you did it pretty well. Your team went a long way. First of all, you were battle-tested. That had to make your team mentally tougher. Throughout the course of the season to play all these good teams, and you played a really challenging schedule. And obviously it prepared you well, but it had to get that team mentally tougher throughout.
Definitely.
And as a result, when you got the opportunity to go to the playoffs, there wasn't anything that was going to scare these kids.
No, sir. It was a good group of kids. I coached them since they were freshmen. From the moment I got them, we just really focused on being mentally tough. Just working with them, helping them understand the game of basketball, also how academics work and it aligns to athletics. And they were just tough, man. They were like sponges since I got those kids 4 years ago. And I'm just happy that they were able to do something this year that's going to remain in history.
Well, the good news is you've got good players coming back. I mean, it was a very good basketball team this past year, but you've got some very good players coming back. The future is really bright.
Yes, sir. We have a few freshmen coming in. Hopefully that will be good and help support some of those guys that's coming back. Deion Ware, Jalen Hicks, Solomon Washington, Dorian Finister. Those are kids that got a chance to get some varsity experience this year. Two out of the four, Solomon Washington, Dorian Finister, were kind of our main guys. And those kids, you know, get a chance to be leaders this year, step into new roles. And just add to the game.
Seemed like they had a lid on the rim, right, when you played Bro Bridge. I mean, ball just wouldn't go down. Couldn't score. You stopped them. You held them down pretty well. You just couldn't get the ball in the basket, man.
Yeah, man. It was just one of those games where, you know, we struggle shooting the ball. It's something that kind of hunts me every day. Just looking back at that game, we shot it pretty bad. I want to say we scored maybe – 9 points total in the second half alone. And that's just – it hurts, but it's definitely something that we all can look at. We can study. We can figure out what we can do better if we ever in that situation again. And I definitely think it's something that our coaching staff along with our players can build on to prepare us for what comes next this year. Can't hear you.
The caution, of course, with the virus was big. Let's start there. I mean, clearly, it's been a strange year when you're talking about having that kind of issue when you're dealing with the virus, and nobody knows what's real, what's not, and how long, and you know, and what the answers are. And then, of course, on the back end of that, the societal issues that have taken place in the last couple of weeks, which happened for legitimate reasons and as a legitimate cause, and there has to be a legitimate solution to this. So this has been a very unusual year. Just talk about, first of all, you have to be without your kids because of the virus, and now secondly, when you do get them back, you know, how you try to mentor them into dealing with the societal issues we have.
One of the things, you know, we do a lot is we communicate a lot, teaching my guys togetherness. The coach has been in touch with our players throughout this whole time, you know, just mainly checking on their families, checking on their well-being, making sure that everybody is safe and supported throughout this time. It kind of caught us by surprise a little bit, you know, with kids getting dismissed from school, and we had to, you know, first take care of them academically, make sure that they were closing out the academic year on good terms, and then kind of sending those guys some workouts that they could do from home to kind of keep them active, keep their spirits up, and, you know, kind of keep them in a good place with everything that's going on in the world.
And then with regard to social justice and what's happening right now, just your own personal experiences, Nate, growing up, what you've gone through, how much racism or discrimination have you experienced as an individual, as a human being? Has it been something significant? And is there any compelling story that might illustrate to people and help people understand why people feel the way they do?
I would say it's been some experiences I had growing up as a child that kind of opened my eyes to some of the racist, injustice things that's going on in today's world. For me, you know, it's kind of been a little different. You know, being an athlete, people kind of tend to treat you a certain kind of way. But having friends that come from environments or neighborhood where it's just a struggle, you know, we see a lot of things happen. And, you know, it brings joy to my eyes sometimes to see people out there protesting for the cause, doing things that's going to help us, you know, passing laws that's going to protect us. And, you know, mainly with our kids, we just trying to communicate to them, you know, be cautious, be careful, and also be knowledgeable. You know, this is a time where we can educate our people, educate our kids on, you know, how to do things the right way to create a positive change.
Many of us, myself included, have not had anything close to the experiences that you and many of your young men have had. And if you want to call that privilege, you certainly can, because I couldn't possibly understand what it would be like to be profiled or to be pulled over and stopped for no reason or to be harassed when that transpires. And again, as I've said continuously, I'm not here to vilify law enforcement. Most of the people in that field are good people. They're bold. They're doing their jobs and they risk their lives. I get that. There's bad people in it and they've done bad things in many other phases of life. And yet, what I've been trying to do is gain an understanding and to help people understand why people feel the way that they do. Did you ever have to have a lot of coaches have told me that their parents had to have the talk with them about what to do, you know, if they ever get pulled over. Did that happen with you at all?
Unfortunately, I didn't get that talk with my parents, but growing up, I did have a situation where me and some friends were in a park driving. You know, I was teaching one of my friends how to drive because we just came from a background where our parents didn't do that, and I was fortunate enough to have a car. They didn't. And we had a situation where an undercover cop kind of pulled us out of the car, you know, and had us at gunpoint. And I think for me at that moment, it kind of, like, you know, prepared me to have that talk with my kids, prepared me to have that talk with my players. And, you know, we just kind of used it as something that didn't, like, stigmatize us or profile us. You know, I understood that I had to continue to educate myself, continue to grow as a person to be able to create impact in the community, to keep kids, you know, out of those type of situations, you know, so they can grow up and just do kind of some of the same things I'm doing today.
So important. And did they give you any reason for doing that when it was done to you at that point?
At that time, the guy said that, you know, we were in the park. We were going around in circles. One of my friends was driving. He kind of said that, you know, we kind of swerved over and tried to hit him. But as we were driving, we didn't see anyone. I'm sure he wasn't trying to hit anyone. But as we got out the car to switch places, the guy kind of creeped up on us and, yeah, just asked us to, you know, lay on the ground, had us at gunpoint. And, you know, at that time, we were all high school basketball players, you know, trying to explain ourselves as good kids that go to school, that play sports. And, you know, we were just fighting at the time.
You have such a chance to make such a difference in the lives of young men. And I know you, and I know you take that seriously. And this is such a critical time because I think there will be real change. There's been change in my lifetime. I've seen it. There's been some equity. And there's been some closing of the gap, per se, with regard to jobs and opportunities and even the way people are treated. And yet there's still a long way to go. This is truly an incredibly important time for mentors to be in place. And I know you probably understand and realize that as much as anyone, don't you?
Yes, sir, definitely, man. We just want to keep encouraging kids to educate themselves. So that allowed them to go further in life and, you know, just create positive change. You know, a lot of kids that we impact through the game of basketball, you know, they go to college and they major in criminal justice. They go to college and they major to be doctors, nurses, lawyers. Those are the people that create change in our day-to-day world that we live in today.
No question. And again, these young men develop hope. They develop education. They develop faith through everything that they learn, and it's really, I think, the high school level is really where it's at. That's where the biggest development takes place of any sort. And basketball can play a great role in that, too, because it's an ultimate team game. It requires tremendous commitment, a lot of hard work, and sometimes swallowing your pride for the greater good, right?
Definitely, man. One of the quotes that I read this week that I kind of shared on Twitter was, in order to see the change around you, you have to first create the change within you. So that quote kind of goes out to everybody, you know, whether you're white, black, Asian, whatever. You know, that's something that we all can digest and try to learn from and become better to create a positive change.
Well, we can do that. We should do that. And it's unconscionable that it hasn't been done, to be honest with you. I don't really understand that whole dynamic. I have a hard time understanding how we got here in the first place because it doesn't make any sense to me that anyone would look at somebody as being any different than they are because of where they live or how much money they make or what they look like or what school they went to. It doesn't matter. We're all God's children, and we're all here for a purpose, and our first thought should always be to serve others and to help others, and I've tried to live my life that way. Sometimes I've succeeded. Sometimes I haven't, and I have to strive every day to be better in that regard, and I just think that it's not a very complicated prospect or process at all, is to just think rationally about treating people the way you want to be treated and respecting others regardless of what your opinions are. We can have different opinions, we can have conversations, but at the end of the day, we can all respect each other and get along. It's just not that difficult.
Definitely, man, I agree. It's definitely one of those things that we have to keep trying to improve. Like you say, we can't give up. We have to keep trying, and we have to keep trying to make a positive change.
And I guess you're looking forward to a home game this coming season, right? You remember what your gym looks like, right?
Oh, yeah, man, definitely. Sometimes I dream about it at night, you know, being away from it so much. But definitely excited about the home games at George Washington Culver this year. Me and my staff, Sean, Jamel Sean Forbes, Andrew Inslee, We sat down and, you know, we just kind of put together a real tough competitive schedule that's going to have some really good home games, and hopefully we get the community involved and a ton of people come out and support it. You know, kids are excited and adults as well.
Well, a really good man making a difference at Carver High School with a really good program that's going to continue to be that way for many years to come, Nate Roche. Nate, listen, I appreciate the time tonight. And more than that, I appreciate what you do. Keep making a difference, and I know this world will be a better place, and our community will be. I'm certain of that, my friend. Thank you so much.
Appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
You got it, Nate. Thank you. Nate Roche of Carver High School.